everybody, Day Camp friends, to the Day Camp podcast. It is episode 23, and I'm Andy Pritikin from Liberty Lake in this Philadelphia suburbs of New Jersey.
I'm Sam Thompson from Crystal Lake Park District, northwest of Chicago.
And my name is Ehren Gluckstein from Camp Robin Hood, just outside of Toronto, Canada.
And we are Day Camp Camp Pros, joining forces to provide a forum for Day Camp's folks like you to share ideas and best practices across North America and beyond. And for today's podcast, we are joined by the CEO, camp director himself, though, of the Arbor Group of New Jersey Day Camps, Oak Crest, Pine Grove, Tamarack, my good friend, the camp provocateur, the camp MBA, ladies and gentlemen, Johnathan Gold.
I'm not sure what the camp provocateur means exactly.
Oh, but anyone that's been to any of your tri-state sessions in the last 20 years.
I'm not exactly sure what that means, but if it's good, I'm it, as Muhammad Ali said. Go ahead.
Let's go half glass full and say it's you provoke thought.
Right? Okay, all right, fair.
You're thought provoking.
Okay.
Right? That kind of provocateur.
Okay, I'll take that.
All right. So this Go Camp Pro podcast is sponsored in part by the American Camp Association of New York, New Jersey, dedicated to preserving, promoting, and enhancing the quality of the summer camp experience. Their professional development includes the one and only Tri-State Camp Conference, as well as many other conferences. I know I am buying my tickets to the Maury Stein Management Conference, which is taking place in a few weeks. Should be good. So today's episode is titled Treating Your Day Camp Like an Actual Business. And when I sent that to Johnathan, he, of course, had a wisecrack saying, like, what did you say, Johnathan? It's like calling an apple, right?
Calling an apple a fruit.
Right, because of course it's a business, is what Johnathan always says, right?
Of course
You know, and you know, as he always says, you can't have an awesome camp unless you're actually running a business and getting the damn campers, right? But, you know, what I have found in my years, I'll just speak for myself, is there's a lot of people in the camp industry that got in because they're really nice people, and they're teachers and they're psychologists, and I don't, they may even be lawyers, that whatever, but they want to run around and play kickball with the kids and make a positive impact in their lives and make the world a happy place and sing kumbaya and all that cool stuff. But they never necessarily got formal training in business. They sort of learned by photosynthesis or inertia or something like that. And hence, you know, what we saw when the recession kicked in, you know, last decade, a lot of people struggled. Because all of a sudden they had to run a business because, you know, disposable income wasn't such a ready thing.
And there will be another recession.
Yes.
It's just a business cycle and it will happen again.
Yeah. So before we get heavy and start scaring everybody, let's, Johnathan, tell us how you got into this crazy day camp thing, because your origin story is a good one.
I'll try to keep it brief because I know that, it's not all that fascinating, but I got in, I started with Ben Applebaum back in the 80s working at Ivy League Day Camp and ran through a series of not-for-profit camp jobs all the way from age 28 to 40, 28 to like 38. And I got my first full-time camp director as an employee job up here in New Jersey at Meadowbrook Day Camp in Chester.
All right, I'm going to cut you off for a second because you skipped a great part of the origin story. Okay. You got to go back to the classroom, your MBA classroom in Fordham.
Oh, sorry, I forgot about that. So we were sitting in a finance class, and it was completely providential. I was sitting next to Dan Kagan from Jeff Lakes and Bryn Mawr, and Dan Kagan was then engaged, I think, or just going out with Ira Fish's daughter. Ira Fisher, the former owner of Jeff Lakes, which was like one of the biggest and most well-run day camps in New Jersey. And our assignment was to do an income statement. And I was like, you know, I just did one on some business that I had researched. And then Danny had the income statement there. And I said, what did you do it on? He's like, oh, it's this day camp I work at. And I was like, you can make money at a day camp? That's like profitable. And he's like, look. And I looked at him, I was like, oh my God, are you kidding me? You could do this in camping? And this is 1988. Okay, so this is like 1987 even. So this is a long time ago. So the numbers were a fraction of what they were now. And then it sort of put the bug into my head, like, wait a minute, I could actually do something I love and and make a successful business out of it at the same time, this is a good deal. And that was when I decided to try to pursue a career in camping.
Now, had you gone to camp as a kid?
I went to Camp Beckett in the Berkshires my whole life, and counselor there, and worked up through the ranks, and then worked as a volunteer for Camp Good Times out in California for 6 years, the camp for children with cancer, Ronald McDonald for Good Times. Worked at a variety of different not-for-profit camps before I came into the for-profit world.
But did you ever attend or work at a day camp before you became a camp professional?
I went to day camp 1 year. I was 8 years old, and I absolutely hated it. I absolutely hated it. It was Knights Day Camp somewhere in North Jersey.
And thankfully, out of business. So we're not bad-mouthing an existing camp.
Yeah, it was awful. It was awful. And then my parents just immediately, like good Jewish parents do, shipped me off to sleepaway camp at 9 years old.
All right, so you meet this Ben Applegat guy. He convinces you to drop everything.
All right, and go into day camping, yep.
And then you get the opportunity at Meadowbrook. Right. Well, actually, before you were at Meadowbrook, you worked at the not-for-profit camp life.
Yeah, I worked at several not-for-profit camps. I worked at some Y camps. I worked at was the sleepaway camp director at Pine Forest for a year in 1992, working with Mickey Black, and that was a great experience. And I worked at a Y camp in Westchester for a bit as well.
Mm-hmm.
So,
right.
Been around the block a few times.
Right. And then Johnathan got tired of working for people.
Yeah. And I found a camp that wasn't doing well. I was not for sale. I knocked on the door of the owner. Without an appointment, I just showed up and I said, sell me your camp. And they were like, who are you? And I'm like, I'm the guy that wants to buy your camp. And they're like, all right, fine. You know, well, you know, it's not really for sale, but if it was for sale, they threw out a big number. And I nearly fainted. And I was like, all right, fine. I'm going to put this deal together. And I put the deal together, and I bought Oakcrest in the fall of 2002, and literally took every cent that I had to put up on the table and, get the camp, literally mortgaged my children. I think if the camp hadn't worked out, I think the dime bank would own both my kids now as indentured servants. and fortunately for them, it did work out. And 5 years later, I acquired Pine Grove Day Camp, and 5 years after that, Tamarack Day Camp.
Right. So you are one of the few day camp moguls, I would say.
I'd like to call it maybe on the kiddie slope, Andy. Maybe a mogul on the kiddie hill there, you know, one of those little bumps.
A mogul nonetheless. Yeah, so. All right. So let's talk business.
Okay.
So in the day camp world, right? Let's just talk like 101 here. So you're talking to somebody who's just popping on this podcast, right? Who wants to be a camp professional, right? And who has very little business background per se, but wants to run their own thing at some point. What are the big concepts that you feel that they need to understand?
When I describe it to people, I describe it as a day camp pyramid. Okay. And unfortunately, and I guess this is me being the provocateur, unfortunately, I think most of the systems education we get from the ACA is about the top of the pyramid. And at the very bottom of the pyramid, right, the bottom rung of the pyramid would be your facility and how good your facility is and getting your facility running and making sure all the systems in your facility running. And that's like a huge, think about all the moving parts in any day camp facility, right? Then the next rung would be transportation. And if you're doing door-to-door transportation, anybody who's ever dealt with any bus drivers knows it's like, about as much fun as getting root canal on a daily basis, right?
So are we going up on the pyramid or down?
We're going up.
Okay. All right.
Okay. Then the third level of the pyramid would be staff hiring and staff training, right? Which is now you're starting to get into stuff that the camp association deals with a lot. And then the next level is the actual designing and implementing of the program. This is how I describe this. Again, this is just my Dr. Gold's theory of day camp management. And then the top level, and I really think this is the easiest thing for me to deal with, and my camp directors agree with me, are the actual problems that happen when you're running camp. Like those things are like fun, like dealing with the kids and the kid issues and getting parents on your team or dealing with an upset parent. Like those are the things that are actually those are easy in comparison, but the bottom things in the pyramid are when people want a career in camping, they have to understand that, like, hey, your facility, your transportation, your all that hiring and training, Those things are what make the base of that house. That's what that house is going to get built on. And those are things that are, that require some hardcore business skills. Right. And I haven't even gotten into, you know, the actual financial management of camp. That's like somewhere else in the
pyramid. Yeah. But where is that in the pyramid? Because you say it all the time to me, cash flow is king, right?
Cash flow is king.
Right.
Cash flow
is king. So I would actually is that like draping over the entire pyramid or what?
It's really at the even below the base. It's like the ground that the pyramid is sitting on is that your basic understanding of how the finances of a camp work. Would be you can't begin to build the pyramid without those bricks and understanding, you know, getting a basic understanding of the you know, just the dollars, cents, the financial management and cash flows of your camp is essential. I mean, you wouldn't get into an airplane without knowing how much fuel was in it and try to fly to Hawaii. You wouldn't go on a scuba diving trip with not knowing how much air was in your oxygen tanks, right, in your air tanks. So you would not start running a day camp without knowing how much cash you had and how it was going to work out during the year and how to stay alive. That's like the most important thing. It's the basic.
Right. And how much cash you're going to need to get
through. How much cash you're going to need. Absolutely.
Right.
Yeah. So starting blocks. So
what are the big numbers that need to be controlled, right? That have flexibility in regards to being able to tighten up.
Certainly. I think the biggest two numbers in day camping for us are payroll and transportation. And payroll is, like you were about to say, not just payroll, but there's all sorts of, you know, overtime and payroll compliance laws that are making working in New Jersey, you know, really, really difficult. In fact, I'm going to say this, and again, I'm going to go out there a little bit. I've never seen it as difficult to put out the kind of product, the kind of service that we're used to putting it out, given the current level of regulation and inputs. So I don't think you have a choice if you want to be in this business, but to figure out ways to find efficiencies. Because, you know, we're looking at $10.30 an hour minimum wage for a counselor who's 18 years old this summer. That's, you know, that's pretty good. That's a pretty good salary. And that's something that, you know, traditionally camps don't have to deal with. It's something we have to deal with here in New Jersey. So that's the biggest number.
Right. And then within 5 years, it could be $15 an hour across the country. Right.
Oh, who knows? Yeah.
And just because private camps are paying it doesn't mean that Sam's not going to have to pay it there too. And it doesn't mean that the nonprofit camps who are exempt aren't going to have to pay it, because if that's what the going wage is, if that's what the going rate is for good labor, you know, and Johnathan, you know, made a reference to me the other day. He said, you know, what did he say? FedEx around the corner from him is offering $15 an hour. Choose your hours.
Work when you want.
Right.
Work when you want. You're home for the summer. Work, you know, 10 p.m. to 4 a.m. Sleep. Go to the beach. Come back at 10 p.m. We're good.
And
Ehren, Ehren, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, you know, we've had some major concerns the past couple of years, because they did raise they made a significant increase to the minimum wage within the province of Ontario, but not. We still have an exemption through the Ontario Camps Association, but it's really affected, you know, people's interest in working for, you know, no money for the summer. You know, they have to make a real decision, and we have to do a lot more education with our, you know, with our prospecting and trying to get, you know, people on board with the idea of camp, not just having a job.
Illinois is jumping from $9 an hour to 10, but we're going to plan on trying to go to 11 since it's coming up the next year anyway to get ahead of it. But it's going to be a huge jump this year and a huge budget concern.
And also a smaller pool to draw from. A smaller percent of kids that are home for college in the summer are even working. I think I listened to a podcast where the guy was talking about how parents used to be like, go get a job and, you know, you have to pay for your own books. And now parents are like, well, you know, you need to relax. And, you know, college was stressful and we don't want you to overwork yourself during the summer. So, it's a smaller pool, of kids. And, you know, here are the pluses though. I there are several pluses, at least, that I'm experiencing throughout all three camps. One, a lot of these kids really are looking for an experience as opposed to folding blue jeans in the mall or stuffing FedEx packages or whatever. They want to know that they made a difference. And for those kids, it's great. Number two, even if you're working at Panera for $12 an hour, they're only giving you 20 hours. They're giving you random shifts. So we can say, hey, not only are you going to get more hours at a lower rate, you're going to be too tired to spend the money. So you're going to take all that money and take it back to college, and you're going to have a lot of bank at the end of the summer. So,
oh my God, that's too funny. So staffing, you know, I talk to a lot of camp directors who, you know, have been running pretty overstaffed businesses, you know, because they could, because labor was cheap. And now they're having to either make larger groups or hire better people. I mean, there's all different models in how to do it. You know, we recently did the day camp conference, and I saw you there, Johnathan, at Frogbridge. And, you know, I was talking to their director, who was telling me that they're doing what Riverbend does. They're only hiring like teachers, you know, like college grad kind of people to be their group leaders, to be their unit leaders, because they figure if they have to pay a lot of money, they may as well pay it to people who are, you know, have the experience and can handle more stuff. You know, it's a, you know, I mean, that's part of the issue that we're running into, you know, you and I, where our model of like the college student and the high school student kind of thing, because it's the college students that are really going to make out from this minimum wage thing.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a tough nut. And so, I mean, what the exercise, so to get back to your point, Andy, so the exercise I've been doing at all three of my camps over the past month, and it's an interesting exercise, is I'm taking a look at the financials. I'm really diving into the P&L, and I'm saying, okay, if my payroll is going up 17%, my rough, you know, roughly not all of it, but you know, if minimum wage is going up 17% next summer, and it's going to reflect into a 10 or 12% increase in payroll, where is that 10 or 12% going to come from, right? Only one of two places: bottom line, right, mm-hmm. which we don't want it to, or we have to find the other places in the budget. So we had an Arbor Group meeting. We pulled all our people together, and I said, never come to me and say, Johnathan, can I have this? Can I get this? Okay, because if I am spending a dollar on whatever it is you're asking me for, whether it's a weed trimmer or, you know, something for a program or whatever, I am taking a dollar away from somewhere else. Come to me and say, this is what we need. This is what we're giving up, right? This is how we're going to pay for it. Or come to me and say, this is how it's going to directly impact the value of our product or our service, right? It's like, yes, there are a lot of fun toys in our business that people love to get. And there are a lot of things that, you know, we go to camp shows and your people get all excited. Oh, can we get this? Can we get that? So, and it's all great. It's all great, right? I mean, it's great. And, you know, the kid and all of us as camp directors, which we're all basically big kids, we all want to play on the fun toys and do everything else. But now I think in the new reality, you have to be able to say that literally every dollar you spend is coming from somewhere else. And it's a much tighter sort of philosophy of running a camp. And the way I put it to all my full-time employees was, understand this, at some time in the next 12 months, and I had a group of about a dozen people that represented our full-time team, I said, every single one of you is going to walk into my office and say, Johnathan, I need a raise. I need more money. I'm going to say to you and exactly tell me, you know, I'm going to make you justify your raise by how you're cutting costs. And I'm happy to give you, I'm happy to pay you, you know, whatever, you know, in terms of, and negotiate a raise with you, but you have to really be that person that is guarding, you know, that is just at the gate, making sure that we're not overspending on whatever it is, whether it's from hamburger rolls to baseballs, I don't care. You know, you, the systems have to be there where we have to really start carving waste out of the system. And that's sort of my initial approach to the minimum wage
hike. Which, by the way, is the way most businesses are run.
Oh, yeah.
Right. I mean, that's the way most businesses work, right?
I just assume everybody's doing that.
Right. So. But I think that camps went through a really awesome phase in the 90s and until the recession, right? Mm-hmm. And people got a little, you know, a little fat on the bone, right?
Yeah.
And need to look at that. So it's great that you're empowering your full-time people to look at their own, you know, areas of purveyance, like as to where that they can cut. But if you were just like a dictator and didn't have such great people under you, like where would you be looking at first?
I'd be looking at CapEx on what is absolutely necessary in CapEx.
So let's define that for some people. We got a wide range of people listening here.
Right. All the improvements and maintenance and repairs and new things that you're going to put up at camp next summer. And what is sexy and cool, and then what's really adding value to your program. You know, what is really adding value? And I think that was, you know, you had two very different types of camps in the day camp conference that we were just at. And you can see there are people that really put a ton of money in the facility and go all out. And there are people that are like, okay, this is about the experience. And again, I'm going to probably be a little controversial on this one, but it's really all about the experience, right? It's really, at the end of the day, if it's a good experience, the kids don't care if you have a 3-story water slide. They care they care about the experience they had with their camp counselor, you know? And if that guy is really somebody who made a difference in his or her life or in their lives, then that's what gets people to come back. And I think that the 3-story water slide may be what attracts people to your camp, but the experience is what does it. So, cutting on your CapEx, your capital expenditures, cutting on your program supplies in terms of, you know, what do you absolutely need? And then taking a look at where your waste is, you know, what are the waste things? And you gotta is it presumptuous for me to assume that most people go use QuickBooks or use some sort of accounting software, right? Or
no, they should have something. Yeah.
Okay, right. So the exercise for me is line by line in my financial statement, studying what we spent money on. And then not just what we spent money on, when did we spend it? Okay, because there's one commodity in this whole equation that you cannot buy, and that is time, right? So we have time now to make rational, good decisions about purchasing. And in May and June, we don't. And if you're making a lot of purchasing decisions in May and June, you're not making good purchasing decisions. You're making decisions because you have to, right? So I tell my people, greatness happens in December. Doesn't happen in July, right? There are these direct lines that I can see between what happens in December and January and what happens in June, July, and August. So, you know, your purchasing process really needs to be honed in and focused in on those months when it's quiet, and really anticipating. Now, there are things that I like to say I'm 90% bought by May 1 in terms of everything we need, except for my food and the perishables and all that other good stuff. And that in a perfect world, that would be true. But there's always something that pops up, you know, that's accounted for in your budget as well. Your miscellaneous costs on things that pop up. So trying to keep people on track that way, because you can negotiate better when you have time. You can look at 3 different options when you have time. When it's May 30th, you know, and you need something, you're buying a lifeguard chair. You're going on Amazon and buying a lifeguard chair. You're going, so, you know, that's it. That's it. You need it. You don't have time. You got, you know, this 3 staff members just quit, and you know, this parent is screaming about their bus route, and you just need a lifeguard chair, and you got to get the lifeguard chair. So,
I gotcha. No doubt about it. I think the experience thing is a big deal, and I think that day camps got sucked into this thing during the 90s, you know, during the dot-com phase or whatever you want to call it, where they really felt like, oh, well, what are we doing next year? What's the next big thing? You know, and we train parents, right? Yep. Parents are coming, hey, Johnathan, what are you building for next year? Kind of thing, right?
Yeah.
When in fact, like, who cares? Your kid's going to go from a third grader to a fourth grader. They're going to do new things anyway.
Yeah.
Kind of thing, right?
Yeah. I think we, the paradigm, at least in New Jersey, has got to change. I can't speak for New York and, you know, some of the other.
No, New Jersey's just a trendsetter. We're just ahead of the curve.
Yeah, I think the paradigm has got to change because it can't. I mean, and I felt like I ran a pretty tight camp, and I got to get tighter. I got to get tighter because we're gonna, you know, we're not in a market. And I think a great session at Tri-State would be, you know, running your camp at a mid-level market. And Andy and I, we've talked about this a lot, but you know, we can't charge $8,000 a summer for a kid. And I don't know what it's like up where you guys are, but I'm guessing it's sort of the same thing. And in a mid-level market, how do you do it? You know, you got to run tighter, you got to run leaner.
Right.
Yeah. I've always been amazed actually being at, being at Tri-State and communicate, you know, talking to people from your region specifically about the pricing, because the Canadian market, or at least in Ontario, doesn't sustain those kind of price points that you guys charge. And, our costs, I'm assuming the costs are comparable, but we're several thousand lower on average, I think, for the private camps. here in Canada.
So it's got, you know, it's got to be similar costs. And I don't know, man, I just think it's getting harder.
And
that's how
and
I feel.
I'm nonprofit, and I don't have control over buying the big things. So I have to rely on program and the experience. That's why I have all my tips about how to do things for free or for really cheap. Mm-hmm. So, but even there, you can cut fat too every year.
But in speaking to the guy that's in charge of food service over at Frog Ridge when we were over there, you know, they're making immaculate things. They're doing weddings at $180 a plate over there.
Wow.
But that man, he squeezes every last dime out of his food purveyors and uses different things for different things. And the prices that he gets for food and for his like custodial kind of stuff are just unbelievable because he works at it.
Yeah.
Because he grinds away at it and makes sure that he's getting the best deal, not the most convenient thing, you know? And your metaphor about just going on Amazon, it's so true. But that's a metaphor for lots of things, because you have all these companies that service the camp industry that are they're middlemen, right? They'll help find all these things for you, but of course they're taking a piece. And if you spend the time and actually contact the manufacturer and that kind of thing, you can go a lot more.
Correct. I think it's interesting also, you know, when you're dealing with, I guess we have a wide breadth of camps on you know, that listen to us, and you know, people who have larger full-time staff that are able to spend time researching and negotiating is not necessarily the norm, and a lot of the purchasing is done by people who start in May, and that's the only opportunity they have to make their purchases for the summer. So there's got to be some some savings in paying somebody to come in, you know, during the year, even if that's not really in the budget. You know, being able to have somebody who's just looking after those negotiations throughout the year
Again, I'm going to make some broad assumptions. It's like my first day camp podcast, so I'll make a few assumptions. But look at who we hire and look at where they come from, right? The people that run our activities are typically teachers. Mm-hmm. And in the state of New Jersey, that is a non-resource constrained environment. Okay. And they are used to asking and getting for pretty much almost anything they need. And you know, they will, you know, if they're running an activity or they're running a division and they're, you know, they, and that culture switch doesn't just flip because they come to Liberty Lake in the middle of the summer. You know, they're 10 months out of the year, you know, state employees or municipal employees working in the public schools. And that's a very different mindset than a private business.
Right.
That is a hugely different mindset.
Well, I mean, I think that you're the kids you pull from might be from better school districts, because I think that most teachers actually have tremendous constraints and are used to poor quality because they don't have much of a budget.
Yeah.
And that I actually have to push them to ask for things when things are broken and that kind of thing, because they're sort of used to this is what it is,
right,
kind of thing. But yeah, the point is that teachers are not coming in with a business mindset.
Yeah.
Very few are, right? It's wonderful.
And that goes true to customer service as well. There's a cultural mountain you have to climb to get them to buy into to drink the customer service Kool-Aid also. You know, because it's not something that public schools necessarily do that well.
Right. I'm also fascinated by camps that spend thousands and thousands of dollars on outside entertainment and bring in. Like, to me, if you're hiring 200 staff, 100 staff, whatever it is, you know, hire good people that can do entertaining things.
Yeah.
You know, be creative in your special events.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
I get these phone calls from these companies that oh, you know, we're doing all these camps and all this kind of stuff. And it's like, I'll come in and it's only $7,000. And I'm like, what?
What? So can I tell a little Camp Beckett story?
Sure.
One of my favorite, and I'm really, really dating myself here, so I'm going to apologize. So 1979, I was a counselor for 11-year-old boys at Camp Beckett. And that was the year Skylab fell out of the sky, right? Skylab, the first orbiting space station, fell out of the sky. We took an old refrigerator, busted it up, took a blowtorch to it, made it all burnt. In the middle of the night, me and like four of my buddies dug a crater in the middle of the village green and threw the refrigerator in and made it look like a piece of Skylab had crashed. And that was the start of a special event. Okay.
It could have broke color war with that.
Right. You know, it was like, that, oh my God. And there's, you know, there's some piece missing and we have to find it. And when we went all over camp and, you know, we hid pieces of like refrigerator parts, it was like, great. Okay. And it just, it doesn't really take, when you're working with the imagination of a child, it's already there.
Right. And we're talking about day camp. They're young children. Yes. They're really gullible.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
You know? Yeah. I mean, I probably mentioned once before that the best color war break I ever had is when I got it from Steve Shaman from Mohawk. We had the ice cream bandit and we just had someone steal the ice cream. And we actually didn't give ice cream out for 2 days. And the kids got really upset, you know, and they got apples, you know. Uh-huh. And then we had, you know, we made help. We made wanted posters all over the place. And it was a whole thing. It was great. It cost me like nothing.
So how did you break color war with that at the end? You found the bandit?
Yeah, we involved the police and you know, the local cops, and you know, which was free. And we dressed up one of our maintenance guys as like the Unabomber, and they grabbed him as he sort of, we were running a fire drill, you know, so everybody was lined up and they grabbed him. And yeah, and then he took his mask off and said, it started color war. Hopefully the children weren't too scared.
There you go.
All right. So Johnathan, in the email you sent me today, you said, make sure we talk about burn rate.
Burn rate and cash flow are okay. So, you know, you've launched, you're in the airplane, you're now in the air, you're underwater, you're taking your scuba trip, right? Now you got to make sure you don't die. That's basically it. Okay. So the burn rate is, to me, a tool that I use with my directors. And it's your starting cash at your first week of camp. So first week, meaning like staff training. Whatever cash is minus your mortgage payments, your insurance is all paid by then, and taking your payroll out. Okay, just take your payroll out, because at that point all your payroll should be in a payroll account ready to get, you know, sucked up for the summer. Payroll doesn't count. So what is your burn rate? What are you burning every single week? Right now, if you start keeping your burn rate year to year, what did I burn week one? What did I burn week two? What did I burn? How much cash did I get through in those 8 weeks of camp or 7 weeks or whatever you're doing, right? You start getting an average burn rate, right? And that average weekly burn is something you can use every year to project where you're going to end, right? So to me, like when I start thinking about CapEx and projects and things like that, I want to make sure, you know, how do I know where the summer's going to end? Well, Jesus Christ, by June 15th, by May 1, I'm 98% enrolled. I should be able to know on August 31 exactly, within a few thousand dollars, how much cash I'm going to have left, right? And where we're going to be at the end. And then you can do all your tax calculations. Don't even get me started on that. But you can sort of figure out where you're going to be and how you manage. But that burn rate number during the summer is really, really important, because I can know, I can look back year to year and say, all right, it was 20,000 this week, it was 50,000 this week. And it varies greatly week to week, depending on what's happening at camp. But it sort of smooths out to an average. And I keep not only what the average burn rate is by week in a column, but what the change is, right? Because remember, it's not only what you're burning, but I'm sure it's true at Liberty Lake, it's true at Oak Crest. You're getting money in also during the summer for extensions or random things. So it's a pretty dynamic thing, but the beauty of it is that over time it averages out, and it's a great predictor of where you're going to land at the end of the summer.
So what are you counting as this burned?
Everything
as the burn
else.
Of money?
Everything.
Are you counting your food service?
Food service.
Are you counting your transportation bill? Because you sort of know what that is too.
You know, transportation. I'm sorry, I should have said that too. Transportation is already paid. All those contracts are paid, generally speaking, mm-hmm. or in payable. So it's mostly variable costs.
Like, so you're talking about late, oh my God, we need a new lifeguard chair. It just broke. Mm-hmm. Like that kind of stuff.
Right. Or, you know, somebody comes in and you know, you lost a bus driver, and you know, here's a bus driver that wants to get X amount of money more than whatever you're paying, because, and you're screwed because you got to pay him. So, you know, all the other things that are going into running camp during the week, you know, food, pool supplies, pool repairs, miscellaneous maintenance costs. Trying to think of the other stuff that happens during the summer. Any other program gear that people didn't order, you know, that 10% or whatever, All those things are going in the burn rate. It's everything else but those big costs that you've taken out. And you're starting at whatever that number is. Let's say it's $500,000 or $1 million or $800,000. And you're saying, all right, is my burn rate 30,000 a week, 40,000 a week, 50,000 a week? You know, and I love it when it's down to like 10 or 15,000. I say, oh, we had a great week at camp. You know, it's like we didn't spend too much money. So, you know, it's all the other checks that you're writing during the summer. I think the burn rate to me, is right as the director, as the CEO, as the person who's sort of managing for all this and responsible for all this, it's giving you a handle on what's happening in your camp by way of operation. You know, are people, because a lot of times people are just asking for stuff or stuff's happening. And if that burn rate number is too high, you got a problem. Something's going on. There's something wrong. There's, you know, and you can go back. I go back to my previous burn rates and I see what I did in summers before. And I see, you know, this number looks way out of whack. And I go, oh, it's because I forgot we had to get an extra 3 buses. And that was another $15,000, whatever it is, you know, I'm throwing.
Well, what could be wrong besides that? Like, is it could one of the things that's wrong be like a culture of just that things are, you know, disposable?
It's two things. One, yeah, you're not running as tightly as you should. Or two, you're not managing your payables as well as you should. And managing your payables is important too. So, and I know that some camps like spend a lot, you know, wait a long time to pay out their vendors. You know, I pay every vendor in full, but like, I don't want any payables at the end of any week. At the end of the summer, I just want to know that I'm like, that's the cash I have left.
So you're coming in on the weekends and paying checks as the camp director?
It's
or you have people doing that for you?
No, it's worse than that.
You're at 2 in the morning.
No, it's worse than that. typically, and again, I just came from no money. You know, even when I was not for profit, we always had no money. So I always like, you know, I just always act as if we have no money, which is actually a good way to be when you're running a business. So I, at the end of the week, and we all do it a little differently, but my method is I take a look at all the bills. I enter them all in the QuickBooks. This is on a Friday night before I go home. I knew you were going to think this is ridiculous. And
some people crack open a beer.
Right. And so like 7:30, 8, I'm out of camp. It takes me about an hour to do it, half an hour to do it, whatever. And I'm not saying that there's not a beer open on my desk while I'm doing it.
Okay.
And then, you know, I know roughly where I am and I go home and I relax. And then I don't print those checks out till Sunday. The checks get printed out, they get sent out. So we you know, manage a lot. We do a lot of that internally. And then I know, like, literally my finger's on the pulse of what's going on during the summer. I don't do it multiple times during the week. I don't, you know, mm-hmm. you know, I'm just like, okay, this is what's accumulated. And it's such a big, you know, this is my second podcast. My first one was with Forbes Radio. Okay. So I was telling the Forbes guy, it's such a big bear that you're wrestling with. You know, when you run a camp of 1,000 kids, you know, there are so many moving parts. Like, when do you really have the time to make sure those systems are working properly? And that's sort of my check and control on it. And so the burn rate is important. And the cash flow, I think, is you know, that's your summer control. The cash flow is, and this is the part that I used to get all riled up about. Like, if you don't understand that your cash flow is your income statement expanded out over 12 months, showing all the cash in and out and what you're spending on everything every month, you're not running your business well, because you can't. You need to literally do that. And that's where your budget comes from. That's where, you know, that's where the timing of cash becomes so important, because we're a seasonal business. In a seasonal business, cash flow is everything. It's everything. I don't care what your business is. I don't care if you're down at the Jersey Shore. If you're running a seasonal business, you know, you need to know how you're going to make it through the other 10 months of the year. And that cash flow statement and understanding it and building it yourself and not letting your accountant do it and not letting them overcomplicate it with millions of categories that all have different numbers. Make it simple. Make one for yourself. Hey, here's my camp program equipment. All right, here's my payroll. Here's my food. Just like simple categories where you can like lay it out and manage that to yourself. I think that's a camp director skill that you gotta have today in this world now is essential.
Yep. All right. Take a breath, because I want to tell you that this podcast is also brought to you by CRS, Commercial Recreation Specialists, fine purveyors of the best recreation products for in, on, and around your water. So check out their website at CRS.com. Do you have any CRS products? You use rich whales still?
We have had some, but not recently. I don't have a lake, so.
Yeah.
I mean, I do have a lake.
Lake envy.
Yeah. I do have lake envy.
So, how to keep your people accountable, right? You're talking about these people don't necessarily have business backgrounds and you know, how to get it down to the next level so that it's not just you, you know, watching the books in a way. And, you know, I remember talking to Mike Colton from Ramapo, probably about 10 years ago. And he told me that the best fiscal move he had ever made in his organization was taking away everybody's credit cards so that he's the only one with the credit card.
I don't disagree with Mike on that, but I'll say, I really don't. Because it's, again, in the heat of battle, it's too easy. But what I do is I can't make everybody accountable because I can't, but I can make two or three people accountable, and I can divide up my purchasing through those people, and I can make those people accountable, and those people can do it during the summer. They're the ones that have to, and they're always full-time people. They're always full-time people because they're the ones that know that their raise that they're going to ask me for in November or December is going to be based on, you know, saying no to the fruit cups that somebody wants on a Friday.
Right. Just pause. I'll pause for a moment and just say that, like, every camp director I know has like their own thing that they do that, like, maybe they should have someone else do. Like, remember Ron Leiser used to mow his lawns, right? He found that to be relaxing, right? I do graphic design stuff. I probably should have other people doing it, that kind of thing. Jonathan likes crunching numbers. Jonathan likes staying late on Friday and inputting his expenses into his QuickBooks, right? That's his thing. So trying to give other people this accountability, my question is like, do you really figure out how much money they've saving and figure that into their bonuses and that kind of thing?
No, I really don't. That would be super complicated, and it's possible. And I know people that try to do that, but it's all in the historical data. You know, it's like, we have a good year, you have a good year, you know, like, mm-hmm. and when the cash is left over at the end of the summer for operating, like, you know, you can throw out, we have a great bonus program in the Arbor group where, you know, people have different ways they can take their bonuses. And if you do well, you do well, you know.
What are the different ways you can take your bonus?
Well, you know, we have a pension plan, and we can put in tax-free, you know, if somebody wanted to take a few thousand dollars and, you know, put it towards a retirement plan. You know, you could obviously take some payroll, you know, if there was, we have a profit sharing plan that goes through that as well. And the profit sharing plan is sort of based on how well we do. I just feel like we all win when everybody's in that mode. You know, we all win. And look, I'm not here to tell you it works all the time, mm-hmm. because it doesn't.
No, it's just,
you know,
example.
It doesn't. It doesn't work. It doesn't work in all the camps. Some people don't buy in. Some people don't, you know, are just living in the moment and they don't look ahead. And that's why you have people that are directors, because your job is to look down the road and see the next storm cloud coming.
Right.
So,
going back to your input into things on Friday night, you know, which I would much rather wake up on Saturday morning personally, but, you know, have a shower first. But the timely bookkeeping thing, mm-hmm. I find that so difficult in my organization during the summer that we get so backed up, and then the fall turns into just like, you know, we're like sifting through the piles of receipts and mm-hmm. things like that. Right. So it's one thing to be inputting the things that you need to pay, the bills. Mm-hmm. What my concern is classifying all that stuff that had been purchased during that burn rate time or
correct.
Even in June.
Correct.
You know? So May and June. So, you know, because like you said, to be able to classify these things into categories and be able to look at them more historically, it's just so priceless to be able to do that.
But okay. So here's the thing.
And I hate having to wait until like now to be able to look at that.
No, it sucks. Okay, that sucks, Andy. I'm going to say that.
Yeah, it does.
Here's what I think the problem is. I think the problem is that people make it more complicated than it needs to be. It can be simple. QuickBooks makes it simple. QuickBooks Online makes it even simpler. All right. So now, really, it's got to be accounting in terms that people like us understand. I hated accounting in grad school when I was getting my MBA. I hated it. It made no logical sense to me. Some people love it. I am not one of those people. You know, I love the marketing side. I love the finance side. I love it. but I did not like the accounting side. So I am not an accountant, but I made a very simple chart of accounts, and I make it very simple for people to allocate expenses. And if you know who your vendors are and it's simple, you can look back and go, wait a minute, this was a mistake. Somebody allocated this, this got allocated wrong, and you just pop it into the other category. But for the most part, you know, I make it pretty simple so that the people who have financial responsibility at the individual camps know what a marketing expense is versus an advertising expense, know what a CapEx expense is versus a repair expense, know what a maintenance supply expense, you know, they know these things and they're easy. They're easy.
And when are they putting it in?
They're putting it again, if we're not accruing payables, it forces them to enter them in as they're entering checks, right? So if you're paying your vendors on a weekly basis, then you're entering the categories in on a weekly basis, which means when you stop getting bills from the summer, you're done.
What about credit cards?
Credit cards are more challenging. I'm going to say that, which is why I'm like, during the summer, and this we did not do as well with it last summer, but this coming summer, credit cards are pretty much on an emergency use only basis. But we did better this. We've done better with it than we have before. I think it's not credit cards, by the way.
It's classifying
that are the problem. I think it's Amazon purchases are the problem. They're like really hard to classify. But apparently, and I'm looking into this year, and maybe this will be a subsequent podcast that we do. You know, you can input your credit card statements right into QuickBooks Online, and you can classify the individual stuff. But my thing with that is, and here again, right? This is where the burn rate and the cash flow goes. I spent $50,000 last summer on American Express bills, and I'm just throwing a number out. Mm-hmm. You know? And sometimes you do. You have a teen trip, go out, hotels, you got to put on an Amex card. Great. I know what that number is. I know what that number was this year, last year, the year before, right? Okay. I've now taken that expense out of my burn rate before the summer. I put that in as a payable into QuickBooks as American Express, you know, teen trips, $50,000. Okay. That's out of my cash now. I know what I spent last year on Amex for teen trips, for program, whatever. Those are pre-written into my program prior to the summer. So now I'm just looking at the actual burn rate. And if those numbers are off during the summer, like, whoa, wait a minute. And you got to go, here's the other thing that I think we forget to do. Like, I go on my Amex online to check to see what those numbers are, because all of a sudden, if they're blowing up during the summer, that's a problem. I've had that happen too. So if those numbers are really out of whack, there's something wrong. And that's a method of control. This is why I always say, it's like when you're intimate with your numbers, you know what's wrong. There's something wrong at your camp. When you know, and the only way you can get intimate with your numbers is not to delegate it to somebody else if you're a camp director, but do it yourself.
Maybe we can call this podcast "Getting Intimate with Your Numbers."
Getting intimate with your numbers, you know, and always practice.
It's a provocateur.
Safe accounting. Always be safe, but you know.
So, is there a bookkeeper in the Arbor Group?
We actually just started one. Really, we just started those people, the Profit First people. Mm-hmm. We just started them, and I'll give them a plug because they're doing really well. And so here's where, and again, I'm not trying to come off like I know everything about running a business, and certainly I'm not an accountant and I'm not a bookkeeper, and I can tell you that I am a terrible bank reconciler, you know, reconciling bank statements. So finally this past year we had some, we shoved all that off onto our bookkeeper, but each director is responsible for writing out their own checks at the end of the week and managing their payables and receivables. Mm-hmm. And I just feel like that's what it is to run a business. Hello. That's why I said when I was laughing at the title there when you started, I'm like, you know, an apple is a fruit. Yes.
Well, look, I building a culture, right? It starts from the top and goes down. So something as simple as that, as having people, you know, write their own checks, you know, that is effective. And this, by the way, is from my friend Johnathan here, who, when he was sending his son off to college, wanted him to understand the value of money, made him count $20,000, physically count it.
I think it was 25 and count it out to the bank teller, get a bank check. And we sent it off and said,
first semester,
don't miss a class.
Hey, building a culture. Okay. All right. It's a great.
But here's what happens. Okay. When you do stuff like that, then, you know, they start to get ownership into the P&L. And when they get ownership in the P&L, it's a natural thing. They're gonna wanna do well in the P&L too. And they're like, oh, I did, you know, it feels good when you're running a camp like that. So when you're not intimate in those numbers, it's like, you know, when you worked for a company and payroll came from the payroll department.
No, it's like the stork brought it. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, payroll came from payroll. I got a payroll check from payroll. No, you didn't. You got a payroll check from your customers. Hello. And so you got to get your people closer to that. And there's also caveat to that. There's a huge level of trust that's involved in that. I mean, just a gigantic level of trust. Right. So,
and I think that most small business owners are pretty paranoid when it comes to that in general.
And yeah. And here's the, you know, the flip on that is that people, you know, people can get resentful and they can say, oh, they're doing this and they're doing all the work and you're making all the money and everything else. But I think at the end of the day, you're teaching somebody how to run a business, and that's an invaluable skill. That's an invaluable skill. And I think the people that you want running your camps are somebody that are camp people that know how to run a business.
So my last question, because we're this has been a great podcast. We're running out of time. So let's say that I am this early retirement teacher that has just now become a camp director kind of person, right? And I don't really have this business background. And I just listened to this podcast and it sounds awesome. But I have no idea where to even start. Like, what would you recommend to this person to start learning this kind of stuff, to get a grip on this?
Well,
besides going and getting your master's.
Okay, so your master's would be useless.
Yeah, exactly.
Your MBA would be useless because I'm here to tell you I got mine and I've coached several people through theirs, and most of the professors do not know what it's like to run a small business.
Right.
The places you need to go to really are, and the place I would start is Business 101 would be, I would send that person to say, okay, you're going to go run Camp ABC somewhere else. I need you to give me your best guess on what your break-even point is. Okay, how much money are you going to bring in, what your expenses are going to be, and then I would say, okay, now I need you to break that out into a 12-month cash flow. And all these things can be done on QuickBooks. And then I would probably get that person to understand that basic accounting software, you know, first and foremost, and get them to sort of understand how that works. I hate to say it, this is the kind of stuff that doesn't typically happen at the conferences. But there are financial management things you can find to do, or, you know, you can talk to people like me or talk to people like you and get them in the right way. And you got to get out of the box a little bit. I think I told you about this. We're going to the PALS business conference in the city next month. And one of the sessions we're going to is cutting the waste. And these guys are one of the most efficient fast food companies in the country, PALS Sudden Service Hamburgers. They're a chain down in Tennessee and Kentucky. And I'm fascinated to hear what they have to say, because I've seen their operation and it's great. So you really have to get out of the box a little bit. So to answer your question directly, it's almost a trick question, because if you were a teacher who was retiring at 45 and going to start a camp, you don't know what you don't know.
Right.
So you don't
That's
know
what I'm where, saying. Where do they accumulate this knowledge? Right.
You know, I had the benefit of working at a lot of camps and making a lot of mistakes before I owned a camp. And fortunately, you know, for me and unfortunately for them, it wasn't my money, it was their money. So and I hate to say that, but, you know, there's some truth to it.
You did pretty well at those camps.
I did. But, you know, I stubbed my toe more than once more than once as an owner. And these are just the mistakes you make. But, you know,
so having a good mentor is important, right?
Having a mentor is hugely important.
I mean, let's be honest with your Pine Grove camp with Gary, like he came in as a teacher, didn't know anything about this.
No, he knew absolutely nothing.
And you mentored him, and now I see him struggling with the intimacy of the numbers, just like you would wish he would.
Yes, yes. They are. You know, you have to have somebody that understands the business side of the business, and it's not the top of the pyramid that's important. It's because you can't get to the top of the pyramid unless you're covering your base. You know, it doesn't matter what happens up here. So down at the bottom are the fundamentals of running a business. And that's, I really, from a camp, to speak the camp language and to speak the language of Jack Welch, which is, I don't know if those two things go together. Right. can't we do more when we're more successful? Doesn't it mean more camperships? Doesn't it mean better quality staff? Doesn't it mean, I mean, running your camp efficiently, running your camp in a way that is, you know, tight and you know, when you're on top of the stuff, makes you run a better camp in all aspects of camp operation. In all aspects of camp operation. And when you run a better camp, you're servicing your community better. So it's win-win. You know, that's what that's what Jack Welch says winning is all about. You know, your employers are happy, your customers are happier, you're happier. It's like all the way around, you're doing it. And if you go too far to one way, right, if you're squeezing too much, it's not good. And if you're too loose, it's not good. So it's a little bit of an art form. I really think it is. It's a little bit of, and we can end on this. The equation is simple, right? When you get the tools down, the equation is very, very simple. The equation is how can you relate that expenditure to the quality of the service of camper experience that we're delivering? Can you give me the relationship between buying this and how it's going to affect the children this summer? And if you can't, then you have to rethink that purchase. It's that mm-hmm. simple. It's like it's not complicated stuff. It's just a different way of thinking.
Awesome. So Johnathan, is it possible for you to send us a sort of blank 12-month cash flow thing with just the categories so that we mm-hmm. could upload on our daycamppodcast.com?
Yeah, no, I have samples. I did this in China a bunch of times, Andy. I did like a 2-hour lecture, and they got it, by the way. They were like all over it. They were like, wow, except it took 2 hours longer than it should have because everything I had to do had to be translated to Mandarin. Yeah. But I can find some of the samples that I've used. But yeah, it's pretty simple. And we also have a different sort of, you know, every camp has a different payment model and how they collect money. And, mm-hmm. you know, some camps do a lump sum, some camps do 6-month payments, 3-month payments, whatever.
Right. But still to see a generic one so people can get this concept into their head because it is a great one.
And I'm always happy to talk to anybody that's interested. You know, I always found it fascinating when we did these sessions at Tri-State, you know, 10 people would show up. I'm like, but isn't this the most important thing?
And meanwhile, there's 500 people in the how to run a good staff orientation right next door.
Right, well, exactly.
I guess my point was your pyramid, yeah. right? It sort of reminds me of the Stephen Covey thing with the quadrants, because the financial stuff is not that first quadrant. It's barely even the second quadrant. That's the planning stuff, right? Mm-hmm. And I think that camp directors, especially most camps, you know, the camp directors have multiple, you know, responsibilities. You know, look at Aaron's running outside with a group right now, and then he's got to worry about the transportation. Like, everybody's got multiple things they're doing. And they stay in that immediate area and also the fun area, as you said. It's mm-hmm. fun giving interviews and it's fun planning out special events and all that kind of stuff, right? And then, like, this is the nitty-gritty stuff that, you know, unless you're Johnathan Gold, you really don't take that much joy in crunching these numbers.
I'm not saying it's fun, Andy. I'm just saying
I think you think it's fun.
I don't think it's that much fun anymore. I used to think it was more fun, but I think it's like, hey, is putting gas in your car fun?
Exactly.
No, it's not. But you got to do it to get where you're going. You know.
So when you first get your new car.
Yeah, when you first get your car, it might be fun. But no, gassing up your car is not fun. You know, especially if you don't live in New Jersey, where you can't sit in your car and let other people do it.
Going to make a New Jersey reference there.
There you go. Hey, crazy state. Hey, what are you talking about?
Our crazy state, the People's Republic of New Jersey.
Come People's on. Republic.
All right. So we're going to do the day camp tip of the week. All right. We're going to go nice and quick through it. Okay. And the day camp tip of the week is brought to you by our friends at AM Skyr, insurance broker of the finest camps of America. For almost 100 years, AM Skyr has been a strategic partner with summer camps, ready to support the needs of arising in PR, legal issues, health, facility, and more. Experience the AM Skyr difference. So my day camp tip of the week, just talking about efficiencies and stuff, is I've been using this app called Homebase for my hourly employees. So for my support, you know, my kitchen people, my maintenance people, and I go, you know, I do a lot more than just camp on my site. So I'm doing a lot of weekend things and such. And it's a great app for being able to track people's hours. They log in once you have the app, it knows when you're at the site and you can only clock in when you're at the site, which is a nice thing. It sends all kinds of reminders. It sends the people who are administrators little notes that people haven't shown up and things like that if you want that. And it's great for, you know, transferring it all into payroll. Excuse me. Check out Homebase if you're interested in that. Go ahead, Sam.
All right. So mine was fundraising. We have a local group that does a free lunch program in the summer for kids that may not eat lunch. And they needed, they pair with the food bank, but they needed more money for different age groups or for days when they have a lot of people show up to buy that extra, those extra supplies. So we do penny wars, and each counselor has a jar, and the pennies are positive, but dollars and quarters, anything silver is negative. So you win for your group by putting dollars and quarters and things in the other counselor's jars so that you're going to have the most pennies, they're going to have way negative. And whoever's the most negative, then they get a pie in the face by the kids at the end of the time. And we raised $738 for the food bank for the free lunch program. That's awesome.
We did penny wars just the way you said it for our foundation fundraiser this summer. It was one of the many things we did. And I just have to say, it takes a lot of explaining the first time you do it.
Yeah.
that the silver and the paper are negative. Like, that takes a lot. You got to reiterate that a lot to the youngins. All right. But it is a great idea.
Amazing. Can I?
Yeah, you may.
Jump in. All right. So I was trying to relate this back to our discussion a little bit. And so I wanted to mention something that I did mention, I think, a long time ago, which is this concept of giving out fake money to the staff as an incentive to give shout outs to each other and give thanks. We do kind of a wrap up circle with different groups of staff at the end of the day. And so right now we use those dollars to those fake dollars to buy special snacks or a special privilege at camp. But why not use them to buy equipment as an incentive for staff to do some great things, get bucks, and then make it a part of the budgeting process. Some of the stuff Johnathan was talking about, have some accountability for buying some new equipment, so we could allocate a small budget for extra whatever things that we need throughout the summer, and the staff could have an incentive to earn these bucks and then buy some special program equipment. I don't know if it'll work, but something I
was creativity is cheap. As long as we call them Gluck Bucks.
That's what I call them. That is what I call
them. All right, Johnathan, you got anything?
I didn't know I was going to do a tip of the week. So.
You don't have to. You've already given us plenty of tips.
I don't have anything off the top of my head.
All right. Well, then don't sweat it, my friend. Okay. All right. I want to thank Johnathan for coming out and spending an hour with us. It was awesome. There will be more in the future, I am sure. I also want to thank Mr. Go Camp Pro, Travis Allison, for helping us get the show out to you, our producer, Matt Hansberger, our generous sponsors, ACA New York, New Jersey, Commercial Recreation Specialists, and AM Skyer for allowing us to bring this podcast to you. And if you don't want to miss an episode of the Day Camp Pod, you should subscribe on iTunes or wherever you get your favorite podcast from. And don't forget to show us some love. Give us some ratings. That would be nice. Send us some emails. Check out some show notes at daycamppodcast.com. Email us at daycampquestions@gocamp.pro. And we will be back in 2 weeks with some more interesting topics and guests that will make you a better day camp professional and improve your day camp for your campers and your staff. This has been the Day Camp Pod.